Yeah, good morning, and very nice to follow the award giving by the Sydney Embassy, which I'm a happy member of. So that was a good start to the day. Doing the research for going down here and preparing, as it was said, it was my first trip to go here. I noticed a little, funny observation I made. Many of you will know that we hosted your Eurovision Song Contest a few weeks ago in Copenhagen, Denmark, where I live. And it seems that the Eurovision is equally popular to the Australians that cycling is to us Danes. I thought that was a kind of a funny observation to do before going. And you can even see that we made it possible to combine those two good things by even serving the food at the Eurovision venue by bicycles. So I thought that was kind of a connection between my trip going down here and what you seem to like to watch on television down here. But obviously, that is not what I'm going to talk about today. I'll be talking about cycling, obviously, but cycling on street level and cycling in eye level of people. So I won't be going into all the other positive aspects of cycling, such as the potential of creating jobs, transporting on goods, and all the positive health aspects cycling has to it. But I will focus on the everyday living, where you just use cycling as a simple part of your life, and how it is to live in a cycle-friendly community. It may come to a surprise to some of you, but us Danes are actually some of the happiest people on earth. And I will claim, at least it goes for me personally, that if I didn't have all that cycling around me, I will be less happy. It plays a great part in our lives. But what I think we should do is, we should ask each other, and ourselves for that matter, whom are we making cities for? Are we making cities for those who just drive through them? Or are we making cities for those who stop and spend time and take part in the social interaction that the city makes possible for us? I find cyclists and pedestrians a great way of interacting and socializing in your city, because it makes it easy for you to make those stops and take part in what your city offers you, and thereby contributing to creating great livability. And I think that is what it's all about. It is creating great livability. That is what we should aim for. Obviously, the bicycle doesn't do it in itself, but it plays a major role. I often hear around the world that people are asking that they want to be like Denmark, or the Netherlands for that matter. And I think the good news is that you can, but you will have to keep in mind... I was too quick there. You have to keep in mind that it's taking us such a long time to go there. It's decades of hard work to go there. So you need to be patient. But I'm pretty convinced that a lot of cities can go very far, and probably even in less time that we spend of getting to the levels of cycling that we are now, that we have now. But it will obviously take political courage and commitment, and of course also the sufficient funding to make that happen. But I think one thing is, as close to my heart is, I think a lot of these startup and cycling cities that a lot of you will be representing are afraid of making mistakes. So that sometimes refrains you from actually doing anything on cycling, because you want to do everything perfect from the beginning. And I understand that. I mean, perfect is nice. But we all do mistakes. I do mistakes. Cities do mistakes. It's just what's happened. So instead of being afraid of doing the mistakes, I think it's much more important to get things done. And then if it doesn't work, you will have to correct them and learn by your mistakes and get on with it and get things doing, get going, instead of just discussions and make sure that everything is in order, because we do mistakes. But what is it that makes a city work? A common answer would be mobility. But I think the question is, what kind of mobility are we looking for? Again, are we looking for a mobility that brings people across the cities by driving through them? Or are we looking at a mobility that is creating the possibilities for us to stop and take part in our cities and spend time there? Because let's face it, I mean, when we're driving into a car into the city, you don't stop when you go 50 or 60 kilometers per hour. There's no way you're gonna see what's in those shopping windows. You'll just drive by. But when you go on a bicycle on foot, you see what's in those shops, and that might wanna make you make a stop there and do some shopping. I guess we can all agree that what we basically want are streets and cities that are livable and are great places to stay, and you feel safe in them. This is my daughter, Roberta. She's 6 years old. This is on her school run. And she's actually great for business. I mean, she gets pocket money, but she's great for business because She generates business. Like on a school run, she will sometimes ask me, "Daddy, can I get something to eat on the way home?" This supermarket have made a smart business plan. They give out bread rolls for free to kids when they shop. So when we go there, in order to get that bread roll, yes, then sometimes I do my shopping there. Because I'm there, it's convenient and it's easy. So it's smart for the for them, but they also do it because it's easy. It's a very convenient, it's on our way for the school, from school. They made it possible by placing the bicycle racks outside. So it's all in order, it's easy for me. If I was doing this in a car or in transit, it would be complicated. I wouldn't do that stop, but on a bicycle, you can do these multiple stops easily and convenient. So it's good, basically good for the supermarket, as they're getting me as a customer. It's good for me, I get my shopping done while on the school run, that saves me time. And it's obviously also really good for Roberta, which is she's getting that free bread roll. And we do it because it's easy, that's simple. But this is just one example. It happens, luckily, I'm glad to say that this is not only happening in Denmark, it happens in many countries around the world. I think there's like six or seven different cities in a couple of different continents presented on these photos, where also people are using their bicycle to shop. But obviously it needs to be there, the infrastructure needs to be in order. But then you can see examples around the world where people are using their bikes to carry smaller goods with them home. But then you can also ask, is cycling bad for business? Is this club closed because there was no parking outside that didn't make it possible to stop in a car? I would say most likely it's not caused by that. But what cycling does, it opens up different types of shops. One may not buy a fridge or a sofa by bicycle. Probably a bit complicated to bring home on a bicycle. But most of our purchases can actually be brought home on a bicycle. But our shopping habits are so hard embedded in us and can sometimes be hard to shake off. As one, you may be thinking there's a good offer on somewhere on display, so you want to bring the car to bring that home. Maybe the thought that shopping can be done with anything else than a car might even not to occur to you. And of course, that's what you do if that's your habit. But actually, how much do we actually buy when we are shopping? An Austrian study showed that in 8 out of 10 purchases at a supermarket, the thing that the person bought could have been brought home in the bicycle basket or in a shopping bag. But however, only 4 of those people actually did so. So there's room for habit change habit change and improvement on this case. The thing with bringing stuff on a bicycle, luckily also have the future, the tomorrow's product designers. So I hope it's a trend that will carry on. I was lucky enough last year to guest lecture at the Art Academy in Berlin for the product students there. And I was happy to see that a fair portion of the students, voluntarily, I didn't influence them, I think. They decided to work on products where you bring things on your cycle or with you when you cycle. So I guess this is a trend that will carry on. But I probably haven't answered one of my questions yet, but is cycling good for business? A study made by City of Copenhagen showed that it is. If we're looking at small accessible shops, so not the hypermarkets on the outskirts of a city, but accessible shops in the city, bicyclists work up a greater revenue than the car drivers did. One big difference is that the car drivers, they use more, almost the double amount of money when they shop, but they shop less frequently than bicyclists do. But the total revenue is higher for those who shop by bicycle. There might be one or two of you sitting now, or even more, I don't know, sitting, yeah, right, that's Copenhagen, that's Denmark. Bicycling is what they do, so that's so easy for me to say. And you are right. Bicycling is what we do for a lot of us anyway. But then I'm also glad to see that it's happening in many other places and not just in Denmark. And I think basically it has to be around that our street should be accommodating. It should be welcoming us and say, welcome, come here and ride, park and shop in our street. That's what it has to be in order to make it happen. This street is Nørrebrogade in Copenhagen. It's a really busy street. Riding to and from the city center. Try and imagine having up to 40,000 cyclists passing your shop windows a day. That's a great potential for customers. That's 40,000 potential customers daily having a chance to pop in to your shop and do their purchases there. being able to do that is gives them a great possibility, potential. The street hasn't always been like that. The street layout and the design has been changed. The pavements are now at some points up to 6.5 meter wide. The widest part for the cycle path is 4 meter wide and even has like an overtaking lane that we call conversation lines. So we can actually ride breast abreast and have a chat while we do it. The others can rush by if they're in a hurry for whatever reasons. So I think it's an example of creating the foundation for a better city life by providing for this. A better example, in my opinion, is a side street to Nørrebrogade, which is called Elmegade. It has also been changed in the layout. But I think the difference is that this street is about seeing possibilities. Again, the street design was changed. One bus lane was moved to another city, to another street, and it was made a one-way street for car traffic. That freed up space, and that space was literally given to the shop owners. They were told that the space that was now available in front of their shop was for them to use. So what happens when you do that? Of course, cafes, they put out tables and chairs, creating city life there, making it possible to stay and enjoy the street. The small design shop that might be even placed in a basement, but even on a bicycle when you ride by it, you can't see what they have on display. They could now put their whatever they are selling out on the street in eye level of the customers and get this exposure to the customers, creating a much better street for commerce, a much better street for spending time. And what happens is, as I see it, it's now a street that people are embracing and they want to go there and spend time and thereby money, which obviously then support the local economy on the street. But that's again, that was a Copenhagen example. And you could actually see these things in other cities. There's been other studies made around the world, but it also shows the cyclists bring in a good fare of the shopping or the revenue. I brought one example with me, a little story from Portland in the USA. There's a guy called Jesse McCain there. He also saw possibilities. He wanted to open up a bar serving quality beer. So he got a place, and out as part of this venue that he got, the bar, there was also 4 or 5 car parking spots there. And most shop owners would probably think, in a traditional way, think, this is really good for business. Now people can drive over, park, and go in and shop. But McCain thought differently. First thing he did before opening the bar was to put out chairs and tables and bicycle rack on that space that used to be for the car drivers for the parking. So he saw possibilities just as in Elmegade by recreating that space that was available to him. And what happens is that he's quoted to have said, having parking for more than 60 customers just outside your shop on a space that would only allow 4 or 5 cars and thereby 5, 6, 7 people maximum as customers at the same time. That's really awesome. And what he also found was that these type of customers who went there on bike now, they were extremely loyal to his shop. And that's all. And I think loyalty is a really good keyword for shop owners, because if you can, you know, attract your customers and also make them regulars, then you have a good thing going. And the same thing showed in the Copenhagen study of the shopping habits I mentioned earlier, that shoppers that shops either by bicycle or by foot tend to be more loyal towards the shops they go at, whereas motorists are changing more often which kind of shop they go into. So that makes me think that shop owners should be focusing on creating good accessibility and make it convenient and easy for their clients, by bicycle or foot for that matter, to get into their shops, as there's a potential revenue there. But of course, it has to be convenient to shop by bicycle. And without bicycle, as I see, without bicycle parking close by the entrance, it's not convenient. There are different ways. You have the same examples down here. You can have parking on the sidewalks, or you can on the street parking where you remove car parking. But it all takes space, and most cities have a discussion whether how to use their space. But the way I see it as a modern type of Robin Hood, where space for one purpose is reallocated to another purpose, more or less like Robin Hood did by stealing from the rich and giving it on, passing it on to the poor in the good old days. But it's a matter of how are we using our space and how is it redistributed from one purpose to a different purpose. And I think taking advantage of the space in a way that provide for more people on bicycle, for 10 people instead of just one car, as you can see here. The same space that one car will occupy give you the possibility to have up to 10 side bicycles parked at the same spot. And again, going back to how they shop, yeah, car drivers do spend more, about the double amount of money per shopping visit, but it will only take a few cyclists to park in those 10 spots that replaced that one car parking to add up to a higher total revenue as a cyclist. So I think it's clearly a more clever way to use our space and spend the space that we have available, as we can get more people into shops and parking and these things on the same amount of square meters. As it may be politically challenging to remove car parking, I guess it is in most cities, I find that an alternative could be the shopping rack. That is not a new invention. You might even be able to see some of these are a bit rusty and worn, but I guess they can be redesigned and become more modern. But I think it might be, if you're starting up Cycling City, this may be an easier, feasible way to get started, as they are movable and the shops can take it inside after shopping hours. So it's not something that you sort of take that space away from the city all day long. So I think it could be a way as a starting up city that's trying to find your way how to launch your cycling initiatives and striving to find a good way to get started. I think this shopping rack could be your principle of how to provide bicycle parking convenient distance to the shops. And at the same time, it gives you an opportunity as a city to brand your city. I guess all cities in the world have something that they share a lot, that's a characteristic thing that is special for that city, that can be implemented in the rack as well, so you get this branding value at the same time. And that's and by placing these these bicycle parkings close to the entrance, I think it's a major attraction to customers. And attracting customers is basically what it's about if you run a shop. This is a supermarket. They have decided to cater more for cyclists by providing for their facilities. So they have a plan now to place bicycle racks just by the entrance. In this case, they both cater for two-wheeled bicycles, normal bicycles, but we also have a lot of cargo bikes, which can be three wheels and a meter wide. So they also have made space for them. But they made it convenient. They even put up a bicycle pump there so you can inflate your tires while you're shopping. And I think this is key for them. They have done shopping by bicycle, easy and convenient. And I think that is what this is about if you want people shopping by bicycle. It has to be easy and convenient. And then we can also discuss, can we make our designs more clever? Can we use the space clever? Just like the thing with removing one car parking and providing for 10 cycles. I think that's a better use of space, as I mentioned. This is a concept that's called flex parking that I have developed a few years ago. And it takes some of the space issues into consideration. What it does is that brings two purposes together, providing bicycle parking in the daytime when that is in need in this place, and then at the evening and night hours, it becomes car parking, providing for the people living on that street when they have a high demand for car parking. So I think the good thing with this is, instead of saying either car parking or bicycle parking, which is obviously sometimes the case, in this case we can say both, and thereby get a much better use of the space available. So that's an example of what I see is a clever way of using your space. Finally, this is Vera, it's Roberta's sister. She's preteen, with all the things that comes with that. One of those things is that she wants a taste of freedom, not having me, her daddy, tailing her back wheel all the time. And even, I have to admit it, it worries me a little bit to let her loose in traffic. That is what I do, because she wants to be, I mean, she has to be, that's how I grew up as well, free on a bicycle. And I'm convinced that she will grow up and become a super shopper by bicycle, interacting with her friends, socially, going to cafes and hanging out and all these things. And a great part of her life will be on a bicycle, going around to whatever she will be doing in the city. The only business is not good for is basically my wallet, because with two future super shoppers in my household, I think my funds will be drained at some point. But I'll have to live with that, find a way out. And finally, I think, having said all this, I find it fair to say that cities that provide for bicycles are more livable, and businesses are definitely benefiting from it. As I see it, striving and creating livability, cycling is such a strong engine for that. Thank you.
We've got time for a couple of questions. If our volunteers want to grab the microphones and help take them around, if any Velo volunteers want to grab the mics, we've got one over here as well. Just give them a wave if you want your hands on a microphone. Can I start by asking, I don't know what it is with you guys and six-year-old daughters. They seem to be everywhere.
I thought that same thing yesterday. I thought, should I take it? Oh, I keep it.
Do all her friends cycle as well? Is it popular in that sort of age group?
It is, but it depends on where you live and the distance to where you go. In this case, we have around 3.5 kilometers to school, so that's a fair school run we have. But I would say half of her class will cycle, and probably 25% of them will be driven by car, and the rest will walk or arrive on a bus, okay, approximately.
And the flex parking that you said you'd introduce there, is that proven popular? Is that widespread, or is it still slow to take off?
Well, then I have to admit it's slow in the case that it was a year's testing, and that proved that it worked. It didn't cause problems with the interchange and kids and car drivers, and it's been for then. But it hasn't. That's in place, but it hasn't been implemented in other places. But I tested 4 schools for the city of Copenhagen. I think 2 of them were suitable for it with the time difference, but it hasn't been implemented yet.
Okay, microphone over there. Someone wants to ask a question. What have you got, man?
You know, I'm Donald Sachser. I'm a planner from Thames, New Zealand. Niels, thank you for your thoughts, and I really am wanting to embrace a lot of that and take it back to New Zealand. But I think there's one issue which you don't have. Your photographs, everybody is not wearing lids on their heads, and that makes.
I think the youngest daughter did, didn't she? The 6-year-old.
But in the main, that's in New Zealand and Australia. I understand all of Australia also. We've compulsorily got to wear these things.
Yeah.
And so people don't tend to go shopping by bike because you've got this thing on your head all the time and you take it off and putting it on. That's an impediment that's political. So I mean, you're coming from a place where this isn't an issue. So you've got some thoughts on that.
Yeah, I guess we have some advantages there because I definitely think that it's holding your possibilities to move forward. It's restraining them. So, but that's just what you have. You can work for having that law removed, which I don't think is very likely, as I heard it here. So obviously, it is a drawback. It's volunteering for us to wear it. Some people will wear it when they go shopping. I think that looks kind of funny when they walk into a shop with a helmet on. Some people just click it to the, like outside here, click it to the frame of the bicycle, and they're okay with that. And I guess it doesn't. Who wants to steal their helmet anyway? So, but of course, it's easier when you don't have that law, but that's up to you to change, really.
What would you like to ask over there, mate?
Niels, I was just interested in the type of businesses that are putting bike racks and pumps outside businesses. I think you mentioned cafes and bars and supermarkets. Are they the early adopters, or are there some other business categories that are putting out services for cyclists?
First of all, by the cafes, like, it's usually the public, that the municipality would provide that cycling parking. In the case of the supermarket, it can be on their private areas, they can more or less choose for themselves. But of course, as I said, it's probably not a shop that sells fridges or sofas that will that will need to provide so much for cyclists, because most of us wouldn't carry that on a bicycle. Even you have the cargo bikes that can do it. So of course, it's shops where you maybe only have that one bag. But as I also said, most of the purchases from a supermarket, the study I referred to, actually aren't bigger, you know, as a shopping bag or whatever you can fit on your bicycle basket. So in most purposes, it's really not an issue of how much you can, if you need the space you have to carry. So cafes and supermarkets and small goods, clothes and stuff that aren't heavy, is obvious choice to cycle to.
Please give Niels a big round of applause. That was great, Niels. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Can you all hear me? Well, my talk follows well on the last talk and on yesterday's wonderful presentations as well from Jeanette and from Ethan Kent. I want to say that at the beginning, a lot of the work that we've done on built environment and health has focused on something that I am guilty of calling walkability. And I think you're probably looking at it and thinking, what about bikeability? Right? A little bit on that. So we haven't had a really good repository or data on biking enough yet. So one of the things, as you look at the talk, you have to realize that we're making the case for active transport. And it's a very important case to make. And what kinds of strategies? So when we look at all the different interventions and things that you've seen wonderful images of, my talk's going to be a little bit more, I'm going to show you some data. And I'm hoping that you've had enough coffee and that I can speak fast enough and entertaining enough to keep you interested, because I know that when we talk about pushing the bar and changing what we do, what I really liked about Jeanette's talk was the evidence part, that we can actually make the case. And from a health perspective, we're talking economics. The healthcare cost savings of moving from an automobile dependent to an active transportation culture is enormous. The chronic disease costs that we're seeing mounting over sedentary lifestyle and obesity is enormous. And this is really most of our budgets in Western societies we know and elsewhere around the world, whether it's measured clearly or not, is going to healthcare. And it's partly because we have an aging population, but it's something important as a backdrop to my talk. So I don't have as much data on cycling yet, but I go in with the commitment to you all that we're getting it. And actually, one of the policy strategies that we need is to enforce better data collection. Now that we have many cultures that are collecting data on cycling, and we've seen cycling become actually a significant mode share in many of our cities. I live in Vancouver, British Columbia, and we're seeing cycling has almost doubled in the city itself. We're seeing wonderful gains. The fourfold increase in New York is absolutely incredible, using from a cost-benefit perspective, very minimal infrastructure investments that can be reversed if necessary, but they won't be. We're not going to let that happen. So anyways, I love this image because I don't think about just the health impacts of transportation. It's environment and it's energy. And energy is the thing that pulls together health and climate change. It's really all about energy. When we eat, we're fueling ourselves so we can get around. So food is actually, I'm a transportation professor, so I actually see food as a form of transportation. Journey to food is the second most common reason we travel. Journey to work, necessary so we can have enough money to get the food we need to go and do other things. But you can just say, has anybody ever seen this image before? Did anybody in here create this? Maybe so. You are the bicycle wonders of the world, so you guys know more about this than I do. But I think this really kind of has a message for itself. Use it. Take this image. It's a wonderful metaphor. I've been asked before by reporters, can you think of a more fuel or energy efficient mode of travel than a bicycle? Maybe a unicycle? But you're not going to get, probably some of you can do very well on a unicycle. There's a reason that you're here to promote the bicycle. It makes a whole lot of sense for every reason. You get, most trips are in a bikeable distance. They're actually not in a walkable distance. So cycling fits in beautifully in that interconnection between transit and active transportation in the form of walking. So when we think about, this is often the term co-benefits, and actually I added, you've got it here now, is fuel mix. These are technological strategies. If we're to get an 80% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions, we're going to have to do a hell of a lot more than technology. We're going to have to change the way we get around. And I can tell you, and I have an example I'll get to later in my talk, we're talking about basically a 2/3 reduction in vehicle use in terms of distance traveled by cars in the future. So we're going to have to change radically the way we design and build our communities. And one of the first, quickest things we can do is reappropriate road space for cycling. And in Vancouver, they've done that. And our mayor, Gregor Robertson, really took a political hit. But he's strong enough as a mayor to survive it. And now we're seeing more and more acceptance. But the cultural reaction to taking one little lane of traffic on one street of a downtown in Vancouver was unbelievable. And it's actually more of a cultural phenomenon to understand just how embedded we are in this car culture. So I think you were onto that, thinking about what you can do as a collective group to actually put evidence behind the reappropriation of road space in terms of dollars per square foot of retail sales before and after. The actual costs in terms of the impacts that are claimed by businesses are almost non-existent as long as it's done well. So I think this is important. So now I'm going to take you into a little bit of a technical journey. And I won't apologize for it. It's not that bad. It's mostly graphic. So I actually am a landscape architect, and I don't practice anymore, so I draw images of things like that one you just saw. So anyways, you can see built environment. We're talking about activities, land use, and transportation, and how that goes together. We just heard a story about bike-friendly retail. On my street in Vancouver, I live on a bikeway. we have a bike cafe has just shown up. It's wonderful, and I went in, and it's right on the corner, and you're picking up all these bikes, you know, past people cycling by and now meeting each other and forming more of a culture. So that's a wonderful thing cities can do through tax abatement and other incentives to help happen. Bike-friendly retail, very important, a lot we can do to support it. Now, we want to link built environment to healthcare utilization and costs and health itself. This is what I call a causal pathway. And I'm going to show you, this is how we do research on this topic. So each little arrow has its own world of research with tons of evidence that we're trying to build, hopefully a lot of evidence. Some are stronger and some are weaker. There's a behavioral and there's an exposure-based pathway that link the built environment with cost. So we talk about, and I'm actually focusing intentionally on the bottom line because I think it's what motivates decisions. So anyways, we can talk about the behavioral pathway. Well, this is called energy balance. So what you eat and how active you are is a function of where you live. There's been a lot of debate about self-selection, whether or not people living in walkable places are just there because they preferred and they would walk more anywhere. They will walk more. We will walk more when we live in a walkable environment. We will walk less when we don't, regardless of our attitudes. And there's 20 studies all showing the same thing. It's intuitive. It's obvious. So, and that's what the research shows. So basically, what you do in terms of your behavior is a function of where you live. That'll affect how much you weigh. We're pretty sure now there's more causal evidence on this. We now have pre, post, before and after studies. There's not a lot of them, but it makes sense if you build infrastructure and change the relative convenience and comfort of different modes of travel. That's what microeconomic theory is all about. We will change our choice set. We change our behavior. Of course we do. And then we see that affects chronic disease. Diabetes, type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease are the top two, but there's a huge world of unfolding research around mental health. And I'm not talking about it as much today, I don't have enough time, but green space and playability, not just destinations and active transportation and connections, but actually ability to recreate, has very strong associations with mental health. And mental health is also related with physical activity. So there's a lot of interaction, there's a lot of benefit to all of this. So regardless of direct or indirect effects on chronic disease, we see that there's a pathway, and we now have some evidence that is causal. When you build a rail line, we do see more physical activity, we see more biking, we see more walking, we see overall less car dependence. Of course we do, because you made it easier for people to use transit. Ron Sims was my client. He was the CEO, director of King County, where Seattle is. He became deputy director of HUD in the United States, a federal agency, huge agency. And he said to me once, I can't believe we have to prove this stuff. And it's true, it's, you think about it, but it's intuitive, and we have a lot working against us. So travel and air pollution, exposure, emissions, and noise, and respiratory function, there's more evidence here. So the idea is to link all that up. That's what the research does. Well, why should we care? Well, we should care for lots of reasons. First of all, healthcare costs. I mentioned chronic disease. Now, greenhouse gas impacts, obviously, and energy security. We're also faced, in most of our cultures and societies, with an aging population. This is a huge issue from a financial perspective and just one from a dignity perspective. We have an undersupply of places that are bikeable and walkable relative to the demand for them. And how do we know it? Because of the cost for them. Just simple supply and demand. We are not keeping up with radical shifts that have occurred attitudinally in our societies over the last 20 years, 10 years especially, and even in the last 5 years. And I think it was shown yesterday, in Canada and in the United States, many of the younger people aren't even getting driver's licenses. So we're seeing a huge shift, and that's driving in Vancouver. Most people can't afford even a condo. It's about $1,000 or $800 a square foot. Small condo costs about $500,000. A tiny one. And then we see this unmet demand issue. So that's sort of a little bit. And then I thought I would just show quickly, at least in Canada, you can just see most of our, I have this for North America, but basically the rates of obesity are out of control. And often you'll see these maps of different states or provinces. In Australia, I've seen the Australian maps before. So basically, this is really where we're at. So in the US, this is diabetes, this is 2000, it's gotten worse. So we're still actually getting worse in terms of this. You can see the red is bad, and now most of the whole country, the United States, is red. Basically more than 20% obese. That's not good. In fact, obesity was recognized as a disease itself last year by the American Medical Association, and I was actually on a debate with Huffington Post two times. I should have just done it once. I got creamed the second time because they were ready for me. I had these very angry people who were, it's not my fault. It's not, you know, weight is not mine. And I was like, that's not what we're saying. We're just saying we should change the way we build environments so people have a choice to get around and aren't car bound for everything they do. And so they didn't want to hear that answer. I won't do that again. I saw it myself and it made me cry. And I had that drink that I need to buy, which I will do. Anyway, so we have an enormous, now the numbers that you'll see about obesity, what the costs are, they're off the charts. This is actually difficult to measure. This is over 10 years ago, but basically we're talking about an enormous economic impact. Diabetes also follows body weight and diet very much. So as you can see, the trends from 1990 to 95, what's so amazing is the short 10 years. What happened in those 10 years? Diet and car dependence took a hold, and this is really where the infrastructure that we had built. We spend around, in most of all of our societies, around 90 to 95% of our transportation dollars are going into supporting automobile infrastructure. It's not just building new stuff, it's just maintaining the roads and bridges that we have. So that's, and when we saw last year, the census came out in Canada, and I got a lot of calls from the press saying, aren't you surprised with all this evidence and research showing the benefits of walkable places and bikeable places that people aren't changing their behavior? And when the answer is, no, we haven't changed the way we spend our money. The money actually almost to the dollar percent follows the mode, or vice versa. What people do behaviorally is almost tracking exactly bang on with how we're spending our money. What a shock. So this is where we're at now. So one of the things you can do if you're interested on the economics is in 2010, and this is now moving forward, we wrote a report called The Hidden Health Costs of Transportation for American Public Health Association that makes these same obvious intuitive kind of connections, but this was just a conceptualization of this. Now we're trying to put data behind it. So those of us who are in countries with socialized healthcare, which is everywhere but the United States, I think, probably now, but we're moving there. The Affordable Care Act is changing, and that's actually creating an enormous amount of opportunity for turning around places where health should be promoted through healthcare. I won't be talking as much about that, but we're starting to learn a bit about that. So what we build affects our behavior and the quality of our environment and our overall quality of life. And I show this pyramid as a way to think about framing, because I believe that having performance measures, metrics for our governments to respond to at these different levels is important. And we should be doing more what's called performance-based transportation funding. Really, you know, what happens at higher levels of government is that We're the state or we're the federal government. We don't control land use. We don't make the decisions happening at the local level. Our hands are tied. Well, not really. You could say, you know, here's what we require you to do in terms of performance, and then here's the way the money is attached to it. So you may not make those decisions, but we can allocate dollars so that we get the performance we want, and that should include measurable bicycle infrastructure improvements, modes, percentage of spending on cycling, and all kinds of strategies that support cycling that you know that have evidence behind them that they work. How many have heard of Walk Score? Most people in the room. So Walk Score is a tool. You can enter your address on the website and you get a number between 0 and 100. 100 is the most walkable and 0 is the least. We published our work on walkability in the Seattle Times about 10 years ago, and I got a call from a guy who was working at Microsoft who had access to Google images and basically addresses, and he said, I want to build this tool called Walk Score. And so we've been working with them to make Walk Score a better tool, to make it more evidence-based. But there's now Bike Score. How many have heard of Bike Score? So Bike Score was built by some colleagues of mine at the University of British Columbia, Michael Brower and Kay Teschke, and it's really an interesting tool, and it's starting to take off. It's somewhat similar to Walk Score. It's a little bit different. And so anyways, what we're doing is trying to make Walk Score a network-based tool. It's right now an airline distance one. So this is Walk Score. The way it works right now is just airline distance, but we are on the ground, so you can see the differences that you get. The numbers are radically different. So we have to make it network-based, and we're validating that, and we have. So walkability or bikeability, any way you want to think about it, sort of active transportation access, is a function of where you live. So we typically measure these different environments and look at the differences in how mixed use, proximity to destinations, and connectivity. So it's proximity and connectivity are the two constructs, and you can unpack active transportation support of your neighborhood out of those two constructs. We measure it using geographic information systems, and you all have the data that is needed to do it. And I'm going to get into how we develop tools from walkability. Here's an example of two different neighborhoods, and you can see going across, but basically net residential density, the first one, and we're comparing a more and less dense neighborhood. Most of the public understand the concept of density, mixed use, having destinations nearby, more and less. Connectivity is measured in terms of numbers of intersections per unit of area. So back to here, the way this is measured is we just simply count the number of intersections, and it's picking up route directness. But what's really important from a bikeability perspective is that these pathways have the infrastructure on them to support biking, and we know that through Street View. We can actually measure it out of Google Street View, or we audit streetscapes and bring in the measure of the streetscape and how it performs. Are there sidewalks? And all that matters a lot. So these are the different metrics. There's one last measure I will mention, which is called floor area ratio, often called floor space ratio. It's the ratio of square footage to land area. Planners, we know this, right? Why does that matter? It proxies for urban design. It proxies for things like having surface parking or not. Is the building up to the street or not? Are there actually things like street trees and amenities and street furniture and all that there or not? We go and collect that data when we can. But this measure is the best measure we have. And what's so good about it is that it's legally required for every piece of land. So we know that. Here's Toronto, where we've been doing a lot of work, and I'm going to talk about a couple different tools that we've built off. This is what we call a walkability index. It takes all those measures and folds them all together at the postal code, which is one block face. So every single little area on that map has all the parcels built behind it, and it just shows a surface across a region. This is just showing some examples from our work in Seattle. Very simple stuff. You can take away that all these urban form factors that make walkability up and having green space nearby are very significantly related at the 95% level or higher. So 95 is just 1 plus 99 is 2 or 3. So you can see all these things matter. We would have had biking up here, but we didn't have enough data. There's been very poor, historically, regimens and protocols around cycling data. But now we're getting it from TransLink. So we're going to have a map to show exactly and the statistics on cycling. So one of the biggest things we know is that transit investment does promote active transportation. It promotes walking and biking to the degree that cycling is supported as well. So we did a study in Atlanta, where I used to be a professor, and found people were about 3.5 times more likely to get the amount of physical activity they need if they use transit. Makes sense. We also learned something else, that a transit pass actually promotes is significantly related with the likelihood of getting physical activity. So that's a programmatic thing you can do more quickly. Changing physical environments takes more time, so elected officials want to know what are near-term wins. Things that are programmatic are quicker. 2005, we came up with the first study, but basically, people in Atlanta were 2.5 times about 2.5 times more likely to get the amount of physical activity that's recommended, which is basically 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week, which is almost nothing. But that's what most people need in order to offset the likelihood of chronic disease. I published a study showing that driving makes you fat. I don't know if anybody ever heard of that concept, but so time in cars. And I came up with the idea while sitting at a stoplight in my car. And I was doing this study for a whole other reason. And I thought, God, I'm just sitting here. I want to be running. I want to be biking. As we get older, so I made this a way that's easy to understand, even if you don't know statistics. So red arrow up means more likely, and a white arrow down means less likely to be obese. As we get older, spend more time in cars, or if we were a black male or female relative to a white male in our study, people were more likely to be obese. If they were more educated, if they had more money, and if they lived in a mixed-use environment, or if they were especially a white female, they were much less likely to be obese. Well, this is a little different if those of you who do know statistics, what variable up here has the, well, anybody can tell, which one has the highest T ratio? White female. That's different than any other study I've ever seen. And the issue was that our white women in our study underreported their weight. I couldn't believe it. And I was then told, careful, white men can overreport their height. And I said, well, I don't think that would ever happen. Never. So These numbers came out of this, and they've been replicated here in Australia. They've been replicated in California, about five other places, which is interesting. It shows that we actually are systematically related to where we live. There's some stable forces out there in our behavior. As crazy as our behavior is and unpredictable, it's actually not totally. So each additional hour in a car is about a 6% increase in obesity. Well, you might say that's not so much, but there's a lot of hours in cars for certain populations. And it washes across the whole population, and it has direct effects on chronic disease. Every additional kilometer walked is about a 5% reduction. And we need to get the biking one statistic in here is per kilometer biked, and we will. So you just have to be patient now that we have the data and we're starting to get it. We can do that, and you need that number for your causes. So anyways, So one of the things that came out was, driving causes obesity. The more you drive, the bigger you get. And it's kind of a fun little graphic. And at the time, I thought, I was asked, people are going to drive a lot. What do you suggest they do to get physical activity while they drive? And I thought, that's the most depressing question I've ever been asked. And it made me think of the Flintstones, you know. So I'm going to just mention a little bit about kids. This is a picture from Subiaco, which is in Perth, Australia, a wonderful neighborhood. It just shows, different age ranges of youth. So we have 5 to 8, 9 to 11, 12 to 15, and 16 to 20. And you can see what factors matter about whether or not a kid walked. And obviously, you're thinking, we also need to know whether or not a kid biked. We did not have the data for it, but here's just showing walking. And you can see the one thing that's consistent is having some place to play, recreation, some open space, some amenity. And so you can see they were 2.1 times more likely to walk if they had that. 9 to 11-year-olds, density matters most. Well, that's actually a function of distance to school. It's what it is, and we know that from adding that variable in. 12 to 15-year-olds, everything seems to matter, including walkability, and you can see that in those of you, so very significant relationships. But when the kids get to be 16 to 20, we see the relationships start to drop off. So we looked at, and happened to have this information, compared to kids with households with three or more cars. If they had a two-car household, they were 1.4 times more likely to walk. If they had a one-car household, they were 2.6 times more likely to walk. Vehicle ownership is actually incentivized. We actually get a break for adding cars onto our insurance policy. It's cheaper. So we encourage vehicle ownership, and that's what we need to get at. We need to move to a distance-based insurance approach. You don't drive, you don't have to pay for insurance. This is something that's been known for years. We have a buffet approach to insurance. No matter how much you drive, you pay almost the same amount. We get a little break if you don't say you drive to work, but it's not enough. So I think this is a real opportunity for advancement, and we're going to get the same benefits out of cycling from the vehicle ownership. So sometimes we have to solve the problem from the other side of the equation. This is just showing distance to school. Most trips are just for kids very close to school. So school siting policies for biking to school or walking to school are critical. And school districts are often independent, as you know, from the planning requirements that other sectors of our economy have to follow. On the other end of the age spectrum, we have what's called the silver tsunami, which is, I mentioned, the aging population. California will see its 65-plus population more than double. Where will these people want to live? I will be one of them. access to services, less reliance on driving for safety reasons, maintaining independence. And seniors are very different. Younger seniors are certainly, and I've seen in many countries in Europe, even well into their 80s, quite able to cycle. And it's a wonderful mode of transportation, and it's really important for healthy aging. So that's going to be a big part of the future agenda, I'm sure. And then there's the lack of affordable housing. So there is something, though, that we do need. It's not all good news about walkability unless we solve a couple problems. One is air pollution exposure and walkability are highly correlated. And I'm sure some of you have done research and are very aware of research of the question about putting cycling, cyclists in mixed mode travel with trucks nearby and so forth. This is a crisis from a health issue and from a safety perspective as well. I know yesterday there was some discussion around separation versus integration of cycling on major roads. Many of our cities have parallel routes. They're not just, needing to cycle on the major roads. We've done in Vancouver, we've been fortunate to be able to designate, off Broadway or off whatever Main Street, one block over. And that obviously is a low-hanging fruit from an opportunity, but we have to know better about air pollution exposure. Basically, it comes down to policies to move vehicles, highly polluting vehicles and trucks, to certain corridors. So I'm going to wrap up just a little bit on How many of you have heard of scenario planning, the urban planning process? So about maybe 10% of you do. So scenario planning is a way to measure alternatives of the future. So you can take a neighborhood, could even be a transportation corridor, could be a community's long-range plan, and compare how will it perform over time if you build this versus that or that. And that's what it is. So basically, we build in within scenario planning tools all this data I just showed you, all that research, we're now plugging it into software tools to create what effectively are the first generation of evidence-based health impact assessment tools. So conceptually, I'm just going to simplify it to show you how it works. So a neighborhood design feature could be something like the amount of bike infrastructure, bike lanes per capita, let's say we have that data now, and the y-axis here would be the health benefit of having a higher level of cycling infrastructure or a complete bicycle network within a neighborhood so everybody can get around safely on cycling, cycle, whatever. So you can see that that's how this works. It's a direct correlation. So we correlate things like the urban design patterns with outcomes such as physical activity. All forms of active transportation are sometimes included or not. Body weight could be greenhouse gas emissions and energy consumption. So here's San Diego, an example where we measured and built a software tool last year. And you can see we used our walkability as a basis for it. And we compared in a neighborhood where they had a long-range plan to build a transit station. It's called Palomar Gateway, and it's right next to the Mexican border. It's right here. So this is Mexico right here. It's not projected really clear, but this is San Diego right here downtown. Just north of San Diego, they're going to put a train station in, and they're going to build it up and make it denser. It's going to look like this. Here's their build-out. So what they're doing effectively is moving 3,000 people into this neighborhood. And you can see they have 800, they're going to bump it up to 3,800, they're going to knock down some single family, and they're going to bring in multifamily housing. And we're going to, and then a bunch of other factors, but in the interest of time, I'll just jump ahead and show you the results. So what we find applying our data is that daily minutes in cars car time decreased by about 8.46, so the changes are over here. So you can see that one of the big changes was minutes of walking in adults went up about 67%. That's a huge bump. And we see lots of different changes. And also, on this one I had, so you can see diabetes. This is the first time this met with an incredible level of cultural resistance on the public health side. Because now we're saying effectively that this 9.62% in this number here, a reduction of about a 10% reduction in type 2 diabetes. So if 3,000 people are going to move into this place, and you show a 10% reduction in diabetes, which is conservative, that could be 300 less people that will develop type 2 diabetes over the next 20 years. A single case of diabetes could cost $1 million, maybe more, too. Who knows how much to treat that? Of course, we have the health effect that we don't want, but there's an economic argument to be made. So you can multiply that times 300, you're talking one station area. How much did it cost to build that station area, that part of the transit system? Not so much. So the cost benefit could be off the charts. If that's the case, things that Jeanette Sadakhan presented yesterday, like paint and changing the appropriation of space, could be unbelievable. The cost benefits, the dollars behind this could be incredible, and that's what we're going after. So that's just one example. I'm going to wrap up. In Vancouver, we did another experiment. This is Surrey, which is near our fastest growing. It's near downtown Vancouver, a little to the south, growing very quickly. Just this is their long-range plan. They're going to go, and I'm just going to jump ahead. Apologize for that. I just need to show you two numbers. They're going to take what is now a very low density, about 18 dwelling units per acre, and acres, you know, I don't know, you must all think in hectares. Hectares, 2.2 acres, so it's half of a hectare. But 18, and they're going to go to 101. 5.5-fold increase in density. It's unheard of. They're going from a suburban area to a vertical downtown built on transit, and that's phenomenal. And they're doing everything they can to make that happen. And they need all the support they can get, and they're not getting it. But basically, that would show a doubling of active trips in terms of we had walk and bike together in there. And here, I must highlight, we had bicycle to and from work almost double or more than doubled. So we see cycling for exercise went up. And it was a significant increase statistically. So we see the reduction in greenhouse gas, all these different outcomes from applying, and they're all fairly conservative numbers, actually. It's just when you wash them across the whole population that you get this huge effect. So this is also being applied statewide in California now. We're building a software tool for the state. I think there's interest here in Australia, and we have interest in other parts of the world to build tools like this, because we have got to put the evidence behind decision making in a way that makes it easy for people to sit around a table and say, here's your neighborhood. We can put a laptop out and actually show or project it and say, here's your neighborhood built this way, or this way, and here's the relative effects conservatively based on your data of how people behave in these kinds of environments and what the health effects are of that. And it's essential that this happens as soon as possible, because we know decisions are being made in the absence of evidence that already exists. So I think I need to know, I have not paid attention to time. How much time do I? Go on. I'm over time. Okay, so we all, one of the most complex decisions that we ever make is where to live. And what we try to do is actually ask people as part of these studies about, what do you want in a neighborhood? What are you looking for? We ask people to make trade-offs. And I just want to show something that you can kind of I can leave you with, is that here's a continuum. These are people that prefer the most, really prefer a lot of us in this room, most walkable, bikeable places we could find. And here are the ones who want a car-dependent environment, and here's where we live. These people want but don't have a walkable environment. These people want and have it. These want a car-oriented place and have it. And these people live in a bikeable, walkable environment, and they want to get out. And there's all kinds of people. In fact, here's our sample in Atlanta we had. So we distributed these people. This is a published paper called Stepping Towards Causation. And it just shows that we don't all live in the places we prefer. There's lots of trade-offs that these people here and here are not living where they want to live. These folks more are. And what we see is the top two rows are the ones where they prefer, row one and two, they want a walkable environment, a bikeable environment. But the folks in column one don't. They don't walk that much, and they walk half as much as those who have and want and have what they want. So the message here is that we should enable people to exhibit the health-promoting behaviors that they have, and we're undersupplying it in many places. So in summary, it is documenting likely health care costs and benefits of transport. We need to document the likely health care costs and benefits of this. We need to work across sectors, and that means research and practice to integrate the two. Zoning is the tool that's used to control land use in most of our societies. Zoning is not being done in a way that promotes health. In fact, it may be hindering health, yet zoning is legally based on health, safety, and welfare, and we need to fix that. And we need to tie transportation funding to measurable performance. Thank you.